The island of Borneo is best known for its dense rainforest and exotic history. In its remotest areas, travel is difficult and often accomplished only by boat using the rivers as highways. Now, two adventurous mountain bikers will follow an ancient headhunter trail through thick jungle and dark caves, hoping to unlock the secret of a mysterious tribal riddle. Located on the equator in the Pacific Ocean, Borneo is a fascinating land, inhabited by numerous colorful tribes. However, the island is most known for its dynamic landscape, filled with rugged mountains divided by steep valleys, dense and lush tropical rainforests, and a spectacular underworld of giant caves. Millions of years of evolution, uninterrupted by major climatic changes, have created what may be the most diverse and complex forest on Earth. This is an ideal ecosystem for an impressive array of wildlife, with many different species of mammals, reptiles, birds, and insects. In the midst of this rugged environment, Hans Rey and Steve Peat will put their mountain biking skills and physical endurance to the test as they embark on the Headhunter Trail mountain biking expedition. These are two of the top mountain bikers in the world, champions of both precision and speed. They will be the first riders to attempt to negotiate this terrain where no mountain bikes have ventured before. On the northwest coast of this third largest island in the world is the Malaysian state of Sarawak. From the capital city of Kuching, Hans and Steve will make their way to the rainforest of Mulu National Park. Kuching is a modern city with aspects of the traditional ways still intact. Like most fast-developing places in the world, the old and the new often coexist side by side. Hans No Way Rey is a veteran world champion trials rider. He can perform stunts on a mountain bike that most people cannot even imagine. He has come to Borneo at the invitation of Malcolm Jittum, a local sports promoter. Before heading off to the Headhunter Trail, Hans agrees to give a trials riding demonstration to help Malcolm kick off the annual Rainforest Cup bicycle race.
Trials biking is a skillful thing where you ride on and over obstacles. There's competitions all over the world, and in these competitions, you know, each time you put your foot down or you crash, they score points against you.
Hans looks for a victim, or rather a volunteer from the audience, to become his next trials obstacle and ups the ante for making any mistakes on his bike.
I think it feels worse to the person laying down than to me, because to me, I'm just doing my bike thing, I'm trying to be precise.
After some passport and visa delays, Steve Peat finally arrives in Borneo, where he hooks up with Hans. Steve, who has made the journey from his native England, is ranked number 2 in the world of high-speed, big adrenaline downhill racing. Speed is his passion.
I guess a big part of what I do is it's all about speed, so yeah, I suppose I'm a speed freak. Downhill racing is fast, it's getting faster and faster, the bikes are getting better and better. My bike is, it's like a motorcycle really without the engine, so you can go really fast on it, and the terrain that you can hit with it is, it's gnarly. Big rocks, trees, roots, fast downhill, long, fast berms, jumps. It's amazing like the things that the bikes can actually handle. That's a challenge to me. Whenever I ride, I like to ride fast.
In addition to being the first to ride a bike on the famous Headhunter Trail, Hans and Steve went to explore a Headhunter myth that Malcolm has told them about. The Ebons, who are Malcolm's ancestors, were the fiercest headhunters in Borneo. Along with the other longhouse tribes, they talk of a mysterious head that supposedly hangs in a cave somewhere deep in the rainforest. The head has never been taken down. It hangs in defiance of all who try to possess it. Little is known about its location or appearance. Their first stop is at an Ebon longhouse, where Malcolm has friends who will offer the first clues to where the cave and hanging head might be located.
The whole legend of headhunting goes back to wanting to overcome the enemy, you see? Overcome the enemy. But there's a great legend to say that there is a head or a skull or something which is still unclear. We still don't know. That it's very cloudy, this whole mystery, that there is one that's in a great hall all by himself.
The legend was that they told us about this head which hadn't been taken down. It was somewhere in a dwelling, they told us, and nobody had taken this head, so our little mission was to now go search for this head.
Headhunting was an integral part of the tribal warfare rituals in this island's history. It continued until the arrival of the Englishman James Brooke in 1840. Brooke led the Bidayu and Malays in a rebellion which put down the local viceroy, Prince Makota. As a result, Brooke was installed as the Raja of Sarawak. Taking a head in warfare was an essential part of becoming a man for the Ebon people. The heads were reduced to skulls and hung over smoky fires in the longhouses as proof of the heroic deeds of the warriors. Although the practice is now outlawed, a few old skulls can still be found in some of the remote longhouses in the jungles. Before traveling to the jungle, Malcolm directs Hans and Steve to a warm-up run on Mount Santubong, where there is a downhill racing course. Unlike other competitive courses, there is no motorized vehicle shuttle to the top.
That's pretty steep.
That's a hiking bike, if I've ever seen one.
It looks rad. It's like a stairway.
Once at the top, they find the course is still too steep to bike.
We both have flat tires.
Yeah. Oh, you rode 6 feet.
The downhill course is more like an overgrown, washed-out gully. But if anyone can ride this course, it's Hans and Steve.
The interesting thing is about our team here. You know, Steve has some trials background. He always had an interest in it and practiced it a little bit. Me, on the other side, you know, I grew up with the mountain biking scene in the US and I used to race downhill myself a little bit. So it was a nice combination, him being the downhill expert, me being the trials expert, but both, you know, could combine our overall skills.
Steve's spectacular crash does not go unnoticed. Some local orangutans appear perplexed by this odd new animal that travels through their habitat. Perhaps these agile and limber primates could show the riders a thing or two about swift jungle travel. While crossing high above the river, Hans spots a curious yet familiar object below.
Check it out, there's a bike down there. I know, it looks just like one of my old trail bikes.
Yeah, that's what it is.
Hey, don't break my bike. It looks like one of your old trail
bikes. That is one of your old bikes.
Come on, this is a trick.
You know what, I know the guy who used to own this bike.
Yeah?
The headhunter must have gotten him.
I reckon he did.
Alright, should we take this for spares?
The Headhunter Trail lies deep in the rainforest, far from the capital of Kuching. Hans and Steve will have to travel by all means available, plane, land cruiser, and canoe, before reaching the launching point of the trail and finally being able to ride their bikes.
It was time to start the adventure, and Malcolm said he would be more than happy to help us lead into the jungle. He had some contacts there, some tribes and longhouse people he knew.
It's my first time in the jungle. I've always wondered what the jungle would be like and always had a picture in my head of what it would be like.
Get a little bit wet.
Late in the day, they finally arrive at the Rumah Bala Lasong longhouse. It is here where they will spend their first night away from civilization. The local kids are fascinated with the high-tech two-wheelers. The longhouse is the traditional communal dwelling that houses many families under one roof. It remains popular to this day due to the strong family environment it provides to both the young and the old. The hospitality of the longhouse tribes is famous. Hans, Steve, and Malcolm are invited to a festive dinner.
One of my favorite parts of the trip was first night when we got to stay in the Eben longhouse, sleeping on a hard floor and sitting cross-legged. It was simple, but it's just a really nice way, I think.
The gracious host keeps passing them glasses of tuak, a rice wine that is more potent than it tastes. Being careful not to be rude and offend the headman, they accept the bottomless drink.
Dried up. Oh. There's a lick there.
Homemade.
After we almost like consumed their entire stock of rice wine, you know, they offered this dance for us, which was quite nice and quite interesting. There and this whole dance ended up and being they made us part of it and ended up with a bike dance, and we showed them a little demonstration on our side, which was a very neat thing, and it was very cool for them. You know, I don't think they get too much entertainment out there in the rainforest, so we could kind of return a favor for the hospitality.
Recovering from a night of festivities and fun, Hans and Steve focus on their goal ahead. They will continue up the river and deeper into the jungle.
We didn't really know what to expect at all. Most people who gave us advice were not really bike-related people who had no idea what can be done on a bike. There's always this certain unknowingness. There's always unexpected things can happen, and this is what adventures are all about.
See you guys.
So after a really nice experience at the longhouse the night before, we took another little boat ride, and they ended up dropping us off at the head of this trail. It's actually an old Headhunter Trail, and from there the real adventure started for us.
Rivers are the jungle highways, and longboats are the ideal means of transportation.
Going up the river was cool. You could see all the huge rainforest trees, all the vines hanging down over the river, trees falling in the river. We actually saw a lizard just on a tree at the side. Just the experience of being on the boat, the old guy sat at the back driving, it was cool, just going up the river.
We're heading into the rainforest, Headhunter Trail, here we come.
After several hours, they finally arrive at the beginning of the Headhunter Trail. From this point, the riders are on their own. Although exotic and beautiful, the vines and foliage of the jungle could prove to be hazardous and cumbersome for the riders. The Headhunter Trail has a fascinating but notorious history. It is the location of eons of tribal warfare in a deep and dense forest, virtually cut off from the outside world.
The style of bike riding I do, the extreme biking, adventure biking, trials biking, a lot of times you deal with all kinds of different surfaces, from riding on glaciers, riding down waterfalls on lava, and riding in the snow on ice. And you know, these situations here were extreme because the stuff was as slippery as it gets. I mean, it was just like somebody put soap over everything. The way the rainforest is, the roots are very flat, so it's a constant stream of roots. I mean, there was not one 5 foot long piece of the trail which didn't have like 20 roots, you know, going in all different directions.
That's gnarly roots here. Hey Steve, you wanted some roots? There they are.
The roots were really exposed and really slippery. It was hard to get over. Every so often there was a tree that had fallen down. We had to pick the bikes up, climb over the trees, cross creeks.
When I do these trips, a big part of them for me is to ride more than anybody else has. It's not so much about making it from A to B, which is of course very important, but I want to ride a lot from A to B. I don't want to carry my bike from A to B.
It was really tough going and hard work. I think I definitely got some training out of it.
So technical, it was quite difficult. I mean, it was a non-stop workout, you know. You could never really sit down, relax, and spin your bike, you know, do some pedal strokes, you know.
The Headhunter Trail is quickly proving to be a formidable challenge and not just a ride in the park.
My hands are so wet, I slipped, I pushed my weight forward and slipped the handlebar. Went right over. At the first. It sounded like he'd fallen off a cliff. I was in front and I heard him just go, oh! I didn't know what was wrong with him, so I went back to check out, but he just slipped off. He didn't get hurt.
I was on my way to the 7-Eleven. I took a wrong turn.
That one particular section of the trail was only about 12 kilometers long, which is not much for a mountain bike ride. But it took us probably half a day to master that section. It was just like not exactly a trail to recommend for a leisurely mountain bike ride, I would say.
Whoa! Look at this!
we were on the middle of the log and the log was bouncing and I didn't realize Hans was on the log behind me.
There was like pretty deep and really brown looking water beneath us, and smart as we were walking together over it at the same time. And
first.
It was actually one of the funniest things that ever happened. The log broke, we fall down before we knew it. I was like in the water. Steve could just like jump to the edge and hold on to a root or something. He had to let his bike go.
My bike was in the creek, and at first Hans was panicking for a little bit and trying to get out of there. It was a funny situation. He passed me his bike and then he was looking around in the water for my bike. And the water was so dark and full of grim things. I don't know what was in there.
I need to take my backpack off first.
I ended up looking for his bike and it was kind of scary because the water was so brown that we couldn't really see where it was.
It's left, behind your hand. Just there. That's a snake.
I know they have like some weird animals here and I don't want to be in this water where I can't really see what's going on.
Dude, I hope there's no alligators in this.
I kind of started to panic a little bit. At the same time, I couldn't help myself cracking up because it was just like so comical, the whole thing. It was just like one of those classic moments.
Oh, I feel it. Extreme river biking.
Soaked basically. If it wasn't from the humidity, it was from the rain or the sweat or the water crossings or the mud crossings.
We were walking through and it was so humid in the forest that we were just sweating and dripping sweat all day long, so everything was really wet and grime was sticking to it, mud was flaking up.
Get on before I'm off.
We had to carry our bikes close to half of the way of that particular section.
It was a challenge and it was different and it was really tough going and hard work. This trip's been full of crashes for me and Hans. A lot of the time we were laughing just at each other, falling over and slipping, all that kind of stuff. It was fun.
One day I probably counted like 10 or 15 little crashes and tumbles.
I'm all over the jungle today.
I mean, it was just the nature of the course, so it was quite interesting. That's why I have all these scrapes and cuts now. With this constant up and down, you just couldn't avoid getting pedal bites. That's exactly when you slip a pedal and it hits you in the shin, and it's quite painful.
Uh-huh.
we just kept plugging through whether it rained or not.
So humid, dripping, sweat pouring out from everywhere.
Felt like a fish swimming around in the jungle.
This whole headhunting starts to make sense. I want to cut a head off myself right now after riding a trail like this. Yes!
Every little river that we came to, we'd jump in there and roll around in the river and get stoned washed.
Another equally exotic environment lies below the surface of Borneo. Hidden underneath the forested slopes of the mountains is one of the largest limestone cave systems in the world.
Since we were looking for this legend we wanted to solve about this head which hadn't been taken down, we figured the caves might be a very logical place to look for, you know.
Hans and Steve arrange with some local boatmen to take them closer to the mouth of the caves. Growing ever more curious about the headhunter myth, the riders hope that the caves will provide evidence in solving the riddle. Gradually, they make their way towards the entrance of one of the caves.
Hey, this looks like the entrance right here.
Looks like
the
cave's got
a gully. Yeah, that's true
enough. Let's try to go back away.
Yeah.
Get in there.
Gully.
Oh, your light's working.
Perfect. Cave biking. Yee-hee.
Yeah. We came a long way to find this.
I hope it gets a little wilder than this.
But it's worth it when we get in there.
He said it was giant inside.
That's too worth it.
Looks like it's going to be a dead end. I don't think we're going to be able to ride in here, but...
Go anywhere?
I see a hole back there. We're not going to get the bike soon.
What about back here? That's a dead end, too.
Yeah, that's a dead end.
Cool here.
Hey, check this out! Some little bones.
No way!
No way, look at that one. That's like a thigh bone.
Those things are old.
That's huge.
There's all kinds.
Looks like a big guy as well.
Let's see if there's something over there too.
There's all kinds of holes. There could be all kinds of people down here.
There's more bones in here.
What can you see?
Look at this. There's a bunch of stuff right here.
That looks like someone's forehead or something.
Dude, it is. Check this out. It's a full-on skull.
No way. That's the eyebrows.
Yeah.
Well, the eyebrows.
Dude, he found the skull.
This is like Indiana Jones in a lost cave. All these people down here.
We better leave that here or we're going to be haunted by the bad spirits.
The curse of the lost skull.
This is gnarly.
We found a head though. Maybe this is what Malcolm was telling us about.
That is gnarly. Well, we found something, I tell you that.
Deer Cave has the largest entrance of any cave in the world, standing 120 meters high and 140 meters wide. Over 3 million bats make it their home. Their nightly mass exodus to feed is a sight to behold.
It's just like a stream of bats just flowing out of the cave. It was crazy, and then they all went out and spiraled up into the sky.
A cave is definitely a spooky place, especially if you go there by yourself. You've never been there, you don't know what to expect. I'm not a caver, also I don't have much caving experience. I knew those caves were doable in terms of getting through them. I had no idea if they were doable on a bike or not. I always wanted to take my bike into a cave and ride it, and I didn't really expect to be able to ride my bike at all. But those caves are so gigantic and so huge, and there was actually a lot of possibility to ride a bike in there. They were quite slippery and moist, and there was a lot of bats in there and made it already very smelly and challenging.
It was so humid in there and water was just dripping from the roof of the caves. So it was slick and the tires were getting packed up and we were sliding around all over, but we could still ride. The lights on the helmet were perfect, we could see the trail.
On the way out of Deer Cave, Steve suddenly sees something that may give new meaning to the Headhunter myth.
Hey Hans, check this out. It's like a silhouette of a face or something.
Where?
You see it? Come back here and check it out.
What do you mean?
Look, see the nose of the guy? It's all pointed, sharp nose.
Oh, wow, it has a full-on face.
That looks cool, doesn't
it? Look at the hair and the eyes. It's
perfect silhouetted now.
Looks like Abraham Lincoln, actually. Check this out.
Hey, you don't think that's something to do with that legend that Malcolm was saying about, do you?
You know what, a head hanging off the ceiling, it can't be taken.
That one certainly couldn't be taken.
Maybe that's why nobody has taken it.
It was such a remarkable silhouette that it's quite possible that the legend is based on this silhouette which is hanging off the ceiling of this big cave or dwelling and hasn't been taken down because nobody can take it off. That might have very well been the solution to that legend.
With their appetites whetted for more cave biking, Hans and Steve venture into yet another, known as Fairy Cave. Armed with only headlamps and bike lights to illuminate the way, they proceed further into the darkness.
We brought these lights along and we had to be very economic with them because for once we didn't know how long the caves were and how long we would be out there. You definitely need lights in those caves, otherwise there's no way you could even walk through them without a light.
even with the use of lights, a wrong turn can lead quickly into a dead end.
You had like mixed feelings going into those things, you know, but you always knew there was a way back and you would never go somewhere down a cliff where you weren't sure you couldn't go back up if you had to.
Yeah, let's try this other one over there. This looks like a better line anyway.
Eventually, through much trial and error, Hans and Steve work their way through the cave and finally find a way out.
It was an experience to ride in the cave. That's a first for me. I never thought I'd be doing it. It was excellent.
What is it? What you got for me?
Watch out.
Gosh.
What we gotta do now?
The exit provides little relief as they now find themselves high up on the edge of a cliff. They now only have two options: retrace their steps through the cave or rappel down.
I don't want to go back to this cave, I tell you that.
We got some equipment. We could upsail it.
You think that's the way to do it?
All right, let's do it.
The whole trip we were expecting to come to some situations where we might need some rope to maybe rappel. You know, we rappelled before, we knew what we were doing, and I'm glad we got to make use of the ropes. You know, it would have been a bummer to track those things all the way through the jungle without using them.
See you down in a minute.
All right.
Take it steady.
How's it looking down there?
Yep, this big snake in this tree. Yeah. Okay, there we go.
After 4 long days in the jungle and caves of Borneo, Hans and Steve emerge with a few battle scars.
I got heat rashes and scars, scrapes, battle wounds. After those 4 days, I was pretty beat.
Despite the bruises, some new and unusual terrain beckons them.
The day we popped out, we found a small place in the middle of the jungle on the rainforest floor. And it was like black shale, and it was cool, it was a change. Me and Hans actually played around there for a little bit. It was like a playground to us.
Good one.
All right, that's a way better landing.
Look how steep that thing is.
Traveling, I think, is the ultimate teacher, if you want to call it. It's quite challenging and interesting because you research a lot about these different destinations, different cultures, different legends and myths. At the same time, you get to do what is your passion and your hobby and your life, and you get to meet very special people along the way and have good experiences you can collect.